Yeah, you don't need that much. It's not like a little bit. Those will make the whole side. Yeah, my grandfather, I made down the
Good afternoon. First of all, I'm Thomas He from Hmong Village. I'm the general manager here, and I want to open the meeting. And I first and foremost, I want to introduce our board president, so that you know our board president, Song Yan. Just stand up. So we only have very short time, and it's our board president, Song Yan, and one of our owners on site that. Work with me day in and day out. Terry Van, it's over there. Okay, and I'm just gonna welcome everybody to Hmong Village, and thank you, the Deputy Commissioner and Senator He, and your team, both your teams, for taking your busiest time out of your busy schedule to be here, give us some information about. What's happening at the state level, what kind of funding opportunities that our businesses can take advantage of, and if you have any type of technical assistance, technical resources that can help us reaching our final goal. That's the purpose today. And so I'm going to introduce Senator He. He'll be the moderator today, and I will go down the floor and welcome to Hmong Village again. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Thomas. And we're going to be bilingual, multilingual, if you can, just so that we are open our pipeline, our information pipeline to our diverse community. So occasionally I'll be speaking Hmong as well. I also want to encourage those of you who are more comfortable in asking your question or make comments in Hmong, please do so. We have an audience out there, and the intent is so that our people are aware of the work that we do, and also the programs and the grant that we legislator appropriate this year. And on a budget year, I usually host event or trying to see if I can share the information as much as I can, even on my end session report, but more so for this year, because we just gone through the pandemic, you know, and we are recovering. We need to rebuild. So this year we worked very, very hard making sure that, you know, ethnic minority are not left out, and districts like Eastside St. Paul, you know, are included or are aware of the information. The grant will be competitive, but the more people of color or the venue or agency that work with disparity community could apply, and the more we have, the better chance that the money will come to our community. So that's the reason that I invite Deputy Commissioner Kevin McKinnon and also Darielle Dannon, you know, who is the government relations. She's my go-to person to Department of Deed, and go-to person, so that she can filter things that I may not be quite sensitive toward Deed, so she can make things more diplomatic and make sure things work. So I'm going to switch to Hmong, and after that, then I pass the mic to Kevin, Deputy Commissioner, and also Darielle. And we're going to do a 20 minutes, and then after that, Q&A will be from you. And just hard hit us as much as you like, because we want the good information to be out there. And hard hit us in Hmong, too. I don't mind being a translator today, too, so that, you know, our community knows about it. There's a few housekeeping. First of all, there's sign a sheet out here. Make sure you sign it so that we can have my office can have your information, so we can, you know, send my report update to you on a regular basis. Second, there's bathroom is down the hall. You go out here, turn right, keep on going. I think the women bathroom is first, and then the men bathroom is, you have to turn another right. Any other housekeeping? Water is there. My business card is there too. My staff business card is there too. Feel free. You know, and all of you, I'm very happy that during the COVID-19 time, many of you reach out or encourage people and your client to contact my office so that we can get their unemployment request approved, and that's really helped us, our community, tremendously, you know. To survive, mainly, you know, it's not making anybody wealthy or rich, but actually just to barely survive, and I thank all of you, your leadership, for that. So I'm going to switch in Hmong, and Ochauke Metona, Kuyochi, Hame Ituzuzuru Kape, Yo Spirushihala, Chichon Dauha, Tashi. Be the Hmong no, be the Bhutan, the legislator, the state senator, had the house, be Pantau, the Nya, the Bang, Jojo, the Bessing for food. She had the Nya, no, the Nya, and they, you know, Lundau, a Katrame, Bowland, I been, you mean Bang, to Han, Bang, Ji, huh? Okay, the Lundau, and all the day, good sample, be Bow, huh? To so Hmong, we all book our ancestral report at the good Hmong, be fine, yale, jan, let down, she Hmong, no, your Hmong, Jing Champler. To copy Jong Gotau Nya, to Jatun Fincher, the minority, Gurgo Mo, Jevan Hoshi Lozu, Jetanya Zano, a Gucci of Gutoling, Oasu, Guya, George Shang to State Senator, Ha, Ipo Pitcher Otto, a Pitcher House Member, Good Mono Laboy Shizu, the Dai, Putting Yaku Shizu, Johano Chan, Guja, Guato House Member, the Shiotu, Guchi Konto Gong no Ha, that Jiojan, the Lucia Yatam. I'm done, and thank you. I'm just going to be a moderator, a facilitator, you know, reiterate things that is not clear to people. But Deputy Commissioner and Darielle, you have the mic and the time. And, you know, if there's any heated conflict, I'll jump in to calm down. I'm going to be more like a government relation today as well. Okay, so Commissioner.
At the end, there'll be a test, there'll be an evaluation.
Well, thank you so much, Senator Herr, and thank you to all of you for being here today. I hope you all realize the importance of Senator Herr and his voice at the Capitol, and certainly with us. We have worked together for a number of years, appreciate the partnership, and very much appreciate you arranging this and asking us to be here today. You know, Senator Herr serves on a very important committee that runs our department. The Jobs Committee did a lot of work this year. These resources that are before us are unprecedented. We have never had this type of funding for the agency, but also for a variety of the purposes for which we know are so important, and quite frankly, Senator Herr and others on the Jobs Committee in both the House and the Senate have been fighting for years. I'd also just like to extend a thank you to all of you for what you have done in the last 18 months. Communicating in your community, working within your community, getting information out so people understand how to get through the pandemic. It's been incredibly important, but also heartwarming to see how communities have come together and people have stepped up in such a time of uncertainty. And quite frankly, it's been scary over the last year and a half. Hopefully right now we're not getting back into that situation. Obviously we're all monitoring the variants that are out there. And I've been on a number of calls recently with the Department of Health. We're talking about it and certainly talking about the importance of masking and vaccinations. So appreciate your diligence on that as well. So as I mentioned, let me start over. As the Deputy Commissioner of Economic Development at DEED, we run a lot of programs. I have about 65 staff that are entirely focused in economic development. Remember, all of those resources that come to us need to be administered. They need to be adequately dispersed through our many partners all across the state. And so there's a lot of work that goes into making these grants, not only publishing RFPs, evaluating, but then monitoring and ensuring that the money is spent appropriately. And so it's a big responsibility. And we are excited for what we have ahead. And so with that, I'd like to just talk about some of those resources that that we have, and particularly around revitalization and business support. We know that these are important programs, and certainly we've argued for a number of them, as did the legislature, so we're very pleased that it passed. Or all of these things passed. So I'll talk about some of the economic development programs that are available, then I'll have Darielle talk a little bit about some of the workforce items that also passed. We don't want you to forget about that. That's an important component for our jobs committee as well. And then, of course, any questions, as the Senator mentioned, happy to take those today. So, over the last year, we've dispersed about $300 million worth of support, business support. That's through multiple agencies, through multiple programs. This pandemic required a lot, and the legislature and the governor certainly stepped up with providing resources. Now, we know, obviously, there's only so many resources to go around, so it was very challenging. So as far as where we're going, I mentioned unprecedented resources that are coming to our department, $285 million for this fiscal year. And the majority of those programs right now are going to sort of our nonprofit, community-based organizations for revitalization and business support. And so the first program that I'd like to talk about is an $80 million investment that the legislature and governor have made in Main Street economic revitalization. And I know you all have a sheet in front of you as well, I think, hopefully with some of the information on there. But basically, the legislature and governor realized that over the last year and a half, there's been tremendous challenges within communities. And certainly things that have been experienced all across the state, including in the middle of our major cities since last March. And so this program really is designed to support economic development and redevelopment projects that deliver economic impact within communities with the greatest needs. And so this program is an $80 million program for which we will release an RFP next week. I'll get to the dates. It's happening very, very quickly. And this program, essentially, we will give funding to nonprofit organizations, foundations, to community development financial institutions and also to community development corporations. These organizations will then in turn work with the businesses who have projects for revitalization. And basically what this means is rebuilding. Rebuilding, if you think of capital expenses, rebuilding buildings, and addressing some of the greatest economic needs that, that have arisen. There will be three rounds, three grant rounds for this program. The first round, by law, we have to have closed a, or released and closed an RFP by August 31st. And so next Tuesday, August 3rd, we will be releasing an RFP that hopefully will have enough foundations, CDFIs, and CDCs apply where we can get $40 million out. And then these partners will then create programs within the communities to facilitate development. And the next time is before March 1st of 2022. We will do the remaining $40 million. And then if there's any left over after June 30th of 23, we will issue another RFP. Now, these partner organizations will have the ability to run two programs. A $750,000 grant program for which they can be, their investment of $750,000 can be no more than 30% of the total cost of a project. And so if you're rebuilding a building and it costs $5 million, just as an example, or you can only be 30% of that or $1.5 million, which our limit is $750,000, so that would qualify for a full $750,000. The second program that these partner organizations can run is a loan guarantee program. And this is where they can guarantee debt. So if banks or CDFIs or other entities are lending money, our partner organizations can guarantee that money. So if the loan goes bad, the state will back those loans and pay off up to 80% of that loan. So these two programs, we are very hopeful to see a lot of projects and a lot of rebuilding and revitalization happen across the state. 65% of the resources can only be spent in either geography. And either geography means either the metro area or greater Minnesota. And so 65% of 80 million we probably expect will end up in the Twin Cities. And so we're working very hard to get information out to interested applicants on this program. Trying to think if there's anything else I missed on that program for now. If you have questions, Senator Herr mentioned this. These are competitive grants. And so if you have questions, please look at our website. We have a web page specifically for this program. There is an email address where you can ask specific questions, and those questions and answers will be posted on the website. And so basically what I'm getting at is we're trying to give information to everybody so that everybody has the same information. And so we will strive to do that and operate as quickly as possible. Next Thursday, we will be doing a webinar as well, which will detail the RFP and answer a lot of the questions that are out there. Good point. If you are a business that is interested in applying, we will post the partners. And so once our partners are named, we will post those partners. And those partners are who you would work with on your projects. And there's already a tab on the website that's waiting for that. You will also have to work, obviously, with cities. These are development projects. Cities control development projects. So there's some approvals that would be needed, obviously, before money can be dispersed. But so it's a partnership, definitely. And so we look forward to announcing our partners and getting to work on this.
Thank you.
The second program that I want to talk about is a $70 million program called our Main Street Business Relief Program. Many of you, including Thomas, here are well aware of what we did last June with our Small Business Relief Grant Program, which was essentially $10,000 grants to businesses that were impacted through COVID. We will do another grant round of this program for $70 million. We have opened it up to businesses that are a little larger than last time. So businesses with employees up to 200 employees are eligible. We've also increased the grant amounts from $10,000 to $25,000 per business. And this program will open likely in September. And I want to tell you why we're delaying a little bit. We have two things. One, in law, we can only keep this program open for 10 days. And so once we open it, we must close it in 10 days. So prior to that, it's our intention to do as much outreach and communication as possible so people are aware of what they need to apply, how to apply, and just get more information out there. Last summer, we were in a hurry. We stood up this program in 10 days last year. Yes, there were some hiccups along the way, but this time we're trying to be more deliberate, and particularly with our outreach. We will conduct a lottery once again, so we would likely get 30,000 applications again. It's a randomized lottery. The legislature did add some targeted groups, so employees or businesses with six or less employees, obviously, so small businesses have carve out for $18 million. Minority-owned businesses, $10 million, once again. Veteran-owned businesses, women-owned businesses have carve-outs, and, of course, cultural malls. There'll be another $3 million available for cultural malls to apply to us. And so we're excited, obviously, to get moving on both of these programs and hope to start doing a little bit more outreach on that program once we launch this revitalization program. It'll give us a little breather while people are applying to that. We can focus a little bit more on getting the word out on our business relief program. Good point. We are prioritizing businesses who did not receive funding in previous grant rounds. And so what that means is we've run four or five different programs over the past year, the Small Business Emergency Loans. We ran the Small Business Relief Grant Program. We ran the Loan Guarantee Program. The counties had money, and they were providing money to businesses. So if you'd received awards from those programs, it's not that you're not eligible, but you will not be in the priority list. We are trying to reach deeper and as many businesses that haven't had the assistance as before. So thank you, Dario. There is another one that might be of interest to you. We changed the requirement on Secretary of State, and so businesses had to be registered with the Secretary of State in the previous grant round by a certain date. This time, we will just ask that you register with the Secretary of State before we disperse the funds. Hopefully, it'll be a little easier for everyone. There's a lot of details here, okay, for these programs, and we're trying to convey as much information as we can. The next program is a $10 million program that we are calling our Small Business Partnership Grants. Some of you are probably aware of a previous program we ran called our Business Development Competitive Grant Program. Excuse me. Where, you know, the Hmong American Partnership and other nonprofit organizations, NDC, as an example, are partners with us. We are running an additional program this year with $10 million of resources. This is a very large increase, $7 million more for these partnership grants. And so basically what this means is we will do an RFP, and nonprofit organizations who serve businesses will apply to us, tell us what their program is, and how they anticipate supporting businesses with technical assistance. And as such, we will then make grants to these nonprofits. We have a variety of great nonprofit partners whom this past year and a half we couldn't have done without them. They are also asked to step up here on all of these programs as well. But with this one, we will be announcing this probably in mid-August, I would assume, and nonprofits will have 45 days in which to apply to us. Then we'll make decisions, and then we'll get underway with grant agreements. You know, this program, I think everyone in this room knows very well the struggles that our business community has had over the last year and a half. And so there's a bit of response to the COVID pandemic, but also how do we emerge from this? And these nonprofits that we work with provide that critical technical assistance and support for our businesses that we're really excited about. And quite frankly, we're excited about providing them more resources to reach more people, to provide either greater levels of funding to some of our organizations, or there are many organizations that have not quite been able to compete in our grant programs. And so we're really excited about potentially adding new partners who serve very important communities all across the state. And so this program, as I mentioned, will release sometime in mid-August, and so we'll look to continue to work with our nonprofits. This is also a program that is that prioritizes minority-owned businesses, Indian-owned businesses, vets, women, people owning businesses that have disabilities, and also in Greater Minnesota. So we're really excited about this program as well. Child care grants, we added, we have about $8 million available for child care grants this year. We've run a program at DEED over the last 4 years with about $750,000 a year. So this is a significant investment by the legislature and governor to help solve this child care crisis, which quite frankly has gotten worse through the pandemic as well. People need child care in order to go to work, and certainly we all probably know in this room our businesses need workers right now. And so this is a program where we provide 50% matching grants essentially to increase the quality supply of child care across the state. 50% of the resources will be for Greater Minnesota, 50% for the Twin Cities. And a lot of these programs go with construction, so oftentimes you're refurbishing child care centers, you're outfitting either buildings or the center itself to provide those services. It's not necessarily a program for operations of a child care center, but to really start lowering the cost that prevents folks from getting into the business. This program will be released in the fall. We've got a little bit of time on this one too, and the reason we have a little bit of time is our Department of Human Services also has a lot of money that they have been getting out to child care providers, and so we're taking a little time on this one, but hope to get that out in the fall and get working on that. So those are the main economic development programs that I was happy to talk about. We'll be happy to take questions, but sure. Maybe I'll give Darielle a minute just to talk about some workforce.
Sure. Can I
sure.
Yeah, reiterate in my native language, and if there's anybody that can speak other dialect, like Somali dialect, certainly stand up and translate it too. This is just a recap in Hmong. Let's see. So the recap in Hmong, Kha Chau Chut Le Kha Deputy Commissioner No Nya Ha Tang La Ya Jia Nya Ku Bei Xiong No Bei Fai De Bei Mo Bei Fai Nang Dao De Bei Du Chi Bei Jia Legislator Du Chi Bao De Nya De La Ha De Shi Ma Ku Di Mo Jia Program Jia Lu O E Ba Yong Yi Chau Chut Le Kevin Du Ba Ne Ba Dao Zhong He Han Ma Mang Ha Na Ku Bei Sa Le Gang Sha Jia Ne Mo A Bei Kha Ku Nya Lu Si Le Ku Mainstream Revitalization No Yi Jiao Mi Lian De Ya Lu Chi Ku Mei Jiao Bang ที่มีต้นชาอีลูนานพรอฟิตคือกงเต็นจูเมถ้าหนูปอจิงยอมจอคือนานพรอฟิตจอจูปอขอเว็บไซต์นะแต่อย่าลูกคู่ไม่รู้บ้างรู้เจ้าท่านเนี่ยอีจอดเนี่ยเลยช่างจอมมีเลียนจะรู้บ้างจูจูจอคือจริงจีเต็มเหม่งลุงเดอร์ขอโควิดก็โจคือจงตามโนนะเอเตะขอหาโอจูเมนจีเกจอนเย่นะเจ้าช่วงโนเป้โมช่างมีเลียน จะลูกบ้านจู่ๆจะขอนเดอร์ตัวอย่างเลยกูยังทำไม่เต่าเลยไม่ทอนซีเลยยิ่งร้องไห้หัวจอคือจิตเต่าเลยแต่ขอนโจโปรยโมจอคือจิตเต่าเต่าจะเนี่ยเนาะใช่โอจะอันเดตโลเลยจะคือตัวเต่าเลยใช่ไหมหนูยิ่งเคจูทอนิสตูโมจอจะคือโมเจ้าตัวอินพอยจะกังหูเนาะห้าจะคือยาในฝั่งเจอเลยเป้จะคืออยากกู้ตัวจอ กูตุจอนมายุ่งๆจะไปต่อที่กูตุจอนมาจะตุจอคือยอดโจเตชอเมริกาเนาะไปจากกูตุจอเอสยูโมเฟงโจฮะแต่ชีนี่จีไปจริงไปจริงจีต่อโอจะพาราซีโอโกนึงการทุกคนฮะจะคือลังโลคือเขาพูดอยากจะจื้อคลองเดอร์กูมองโจจะคือคัลเจอร์มอลส์เลยสมาร์ทมอลล์ละมองเวลิชละมองทางเต็นท์นะจริงมองอีกคนยันนึงสิฮะ เขาเนี่ยจะสมอลบิสเนสพาร์ทเนอร์ชิพแกรนด์เนาะแต่ยังมองโจจะกงหูเลยเป็นสื่อแต่จะกงหูเนาะจะคือว่าหรือโจจะเป็นสิงค์กันนะเจ้าก็อยากบอกจะดีเสียดีตัวลูกกงหูเสียดีอยากก่อจีนแต่อยากจะไฟจนนั่นเอาลูกกงหูไอ้คือจะกงหูมองคือแล้วจีคือไม่มาพลายต่อขอโจมีเหรียญเนาะจะลูกปังจะเป็นสิง ถ้าปังสุดจะลังโลเต็มแต่ขอโน้ตเดียวยันยันแต่ไม่เลยซื้อยาแต่ไม่กูสร้างแต่ขอบกิ้งคืนแต่ไม่รู้กองหูนอนลอยยิงร้องไอ้ไม่มองกิ้งคืนเต๋นอนลอยยิงปังแม่สิยาแต่เลยไม่อยากเลยหลังว่าไปซื้อเลยไม่อยากกอยเซ็งไม่อยากไม่รู้กองหูนอนลอยยิงยิงอยากสิหาจะไม่สิมองอัพพลายจะขอโน้ตฮะกอยเซ็งโลลอยยาช่องอยู่ในเดี๋ยวเต็มแต่ในแต่ชิโนกูอยากเตลุจิฟิกูไม่อยากท้อต่อจากแกรนโน ท่านเดียวโยมุญญาโจจะคือจะเนี่ยเราจะอินจังจะอย่าลงซะอินจังอย่างแกรนนะแต่ใส่ต่อแต่ไม่จะต้องเทจักกันแต่เป็นจุดแต่เนื้อโมปั้นโจโจจะเนี่ยโจจะกองหูรูมิโยนั่นหมายโจจะลังโลกือรูมิโยโจโจตั้งแต่เราอยู่มิเลียนเราไม่โมลังโลรูมิโยเราไม่โมกองหูรูมิโยนั่นแต่ช่วงเราไปโมอยู่มิเลียนไฟโจ So I just did a recap, and thank you, Kevin, for, you know, slow the pace, you know, using layman term like me, so we all understand. There you go.
Great. Thank you. Thanks for the recap. I'm feeling very good that we have the paper copies as well. I think that makes the recap a little easier. So thanks, everyone, for, I feel like we have an unusually long list of new programs, which, yes, again, a testament to your tenaciousness along with your colleagues and, you know, fighting for your community. Yeah, it was a very long fight. I think we probably negotiated the budget for an extra maybe month and a half to get here, but I think we had... Well, I know we have historic outcomes, so thank you again. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about the workforce development programs. And this is another place where we have a somewhat historic increase in resources. So we've got about $40 million additional for our workforce development programs than we've had in prior years. That's available in direct appropriations to individual entities. And I'm going to call out a few of them that I think are probably notable for the community here. as well as a number of competitive programs. And we've got some new competitive programs that I also want to highlight. You know, one that has actually one that came out of, I think, goodness, I think you were fighting for, that came out of 2016 and that remains funded, and that we should be, we're going to be putting out an RFP, it's actually out now, is the Southeast Asian Economic Relief Competitive Grant Program. And that's a specific program for the Southeast Asian community around workforce development. Because, of course, I think there was a really great fight some years ago now by our lawmakers, including us under her, acknowledging that certain folks and certain cultural communities have different barriers than other folks. And so getting organizations working with them and employment opportunities has been really successful in getting those individuals into good employment. So we will again have that funding at $2 million for the biennium. And like I said, that request for proposals is open right now. We also have a few new programs, which I think this community might be interested in. One is the Foreign Trained Professional Program. And I think we all have met people who in their home country were a surgeon or a very skilled occupation and have come to this country as an immigrant and weren't able to practice that profession. And this is I'm very excited about this program. This is a new program. It's $2 million over the biennium. We're going to do a competitive RFP. We're awarding funds to organizations who are going to work on that. So we're really looking for folks. It doesn't have to be just healthcare. It was something folks were thinking about the healthcare industry when they created this, but it doesn't have to be just healthcare. It's professional licenses. So organizations who are going to try to kind of break down some of those barriers. So essentially, if you were a surgeon in your home country, certainly the hope is that we can figure out paths that you don't have to go all the way through medical school and all those residencies again here, but that there might be a shorter way to kind of bring those skill sets in. Because, gosh, I don't know about you, but it always breaks my heart a little bit when I talk to my Uber driver and they were, that incredibly skilled professional. So really excited about this program. There's a new program this year. Another one that's I think notable here is, like I said, we have the Southeast Asian Economic Development Competitive Grant Program. We also have a new program specifically like that one for the African immigrant community. And so when we were fighting to sort of recognize that different communities need some skilled professionals who can work with folks who kind of come from different cultural communities, one community we didn't create a competitive program for was that African immigrant community. So this year, that'll be a new program that'll be rolling out. That'll be $2 million as well. Again, very excited. I think that was probably a gap in some of those resources that, you know, we always get these opportunities to go back and look at who's not getting supported by our system. And this is a way that we're kind of helping to fill some of those gaps. And then another really exciting new program that I think the center was probably involved in as well is the Targeted Community Capital Project Grant Program, which is a very long title. So this program was created in recognition that, so capital grants, that's folks who get funding in the bonding bill to build things. So these are cash grants. So these are organizations like nonprofits, it can be cities as well, are eligible for this program. And these are capital funds. So if you're building something, if you're doing phases of a development project, we actually think there's a possibility it might be complementary to one of the programs Kevin talked about. I think we'll see. This is a new program this year. The program has a little bit of a carve out from it, so the total of funds available for competitive funds will be $18 million. It's a grant that we're going to be rolling out a little bit later in our process. But for individual grants, we're going to have $1.5 million per project available. Normally, they'll require some matching funds, but this program will allow us to maybe waive that if necessary. And it is looking to target organizations that haven't been able to get into that big pot. Because I don't know about you, I spend a lot of time at the legislature, and it is, of course, very competitive to get into the capital bill, the bonding bill. But it's also often organizations that know someone or have a lobbyist. And this is really intended to target folks who are not that. So maybe organizations, projects, entities who haven't been able to get bonding funds in the past. And like I said, I've often maybe not been in that list. So that's what this is looking at getting at. It's also targeted towards increasing or expanding services to underserved communities or economically disadvantaged persons or groups. So I think that might certainly be of interest to the community here, I'm imagining. not, you know, not saying that that's necessarily happening, but I think there might be some awesome opportunities, you know, right here in your community. So we're, like I said, that's going to come out a little later in our cycle, but we're really excited to get the word out there. And, you know, I think this was created in statute. So while we have $18 million that are available this round, I think we, at least at the agency, and I bet the legislature too, are really interested to see what comes in and interested in possibilities, maybe putting some more resources into that so that this could maybe be something that's available maybe every year, which would be amazing. So, yeah. So we don't have a date for that RFP yet. We're, you know, we, like I said, Kevin ran through quite a list of RFPs, and I think we're trying to be cognizant of the fact that you all who we're talking to have to respond to all those RFPs. And so we do want to still get that out, hopefully this fall, but really trying to create some space between sort of all the things we already rattled off so that hopefully you can take a breath and we can also announce winners, and then you can make decisions about if it makes sense to come in, you know, for this as well. I'm going to run through just a couple of, I'm not going to list them, but just a couple notable direct appropriations that I think you all might be interested in, because like I said, it was a very hard fight, but one of the great things that came out of it is I think we were able to provide resources to some amazing organizations. So the Hmong American Partnership is one of those that was able, we were able to provide some direct funds for. Also the Hmong Chamber, also 30,000 Feet as an organization, got some resources. One of the other things we are able to continue funding but increase resources for is competitive or capacity building funds. So there's an organization you might know of called Propel for Nonprofits, and they have gotten, they had in the last biennium, they had a small amount of money, and in this next biennium, they're going to have $2 million available for capacity building for very small organizations. So specifically looking at organizations that are, have a budget of $500,000 or less, and specifically organizations led by individuals of color. So that you're really looking to build that capacity, because I think if any of you are know working with the state, we try to make it easy, but it's hard. And working with maybe the federal government or even foundations is also can be really challenging. So really building that capacity so organizations can, you know, become more sophisticated, be ready to receive those funds, and just work on some of the basic things that make them strong. So that'll be some resources as well that'll be available coming out soon. And then the final thing, and then I'll just mention a couple RFPs, and then I'll probably pause and see if the center wants to do a recap. But we also have funding for supportive services again. This is also something that I think came out of some years ago, recognizing that when we're doing work with folks, one of the things that can be a challenge is supporting kind of those wraparound services. So when I have a microphone, it's hard for me to make the... I always like to say, show a wraparound. But really supporting people where they are. So helping to break down some of those barriers that would have helped them be in those workforce training programs. So things like getting to work, childcare, some just even some preparation for work. So, you know, interview attire, things like that. So support services is another program that we actually have continued funding for. And I think our office is certainly feeling we're very passionate about the importance of that, helping folks stay in training and be successful. And I'll mention a couple RFPs that are out right now. So I didn't mention Pathways to Prosperity, but that is our marquee program at our agency for our workforce development. And that request for proposals is out right now. We received about a little over $14 million that we're going to be distributing to organizations that do work with individuals with barriers to employment, help them get into good jobs. So that RFP is out right now. And then, like I said, the Southeast Asian Economic Relief RFP is also out right now. And then that RFP for support services is also going to be coming out in early August. So it's going to be a very busy August, I feel like, in a good way. So with that, I'm going to turn this back over to the senator.
So you want to recap?
Sure. Definitely will recap a little bit. And I think, thank you, Darielle, for, slow down enough that I don't have to go into more detail. So then our workforce development, ก็โอบังโอเจนซีเลยก็ต้องลาฮอลต้นในโลฮอลเลยใช่ไหมเนี่ยก็โอบังโอเจนซีเลยก็ต้องลาหรือต้นในโลอ่ะแต่ยังจีฮอลหรือต้นในโอแต่โมฮอลหรือยินดาวแต่ยี่จงจอลูเซนโนซึ่งเจ้าเป็นไม่ขันยากคือเท่ามองเหมือนกับพันธุ์เชื้อตู้เต่าฮะแต่ยังขันโอยาโจจะเซาท์อีสเอเชียนโจเป็นเจ้าในแต่ตั้งคือท่านาตะจอเนาะเต่าขันยันตาท่านาช่องเนาะ African immigrant the basically more ha ha nzi jo na ja African to to ta na ta jo si ja ta clue ta na ya me tun na me ji zo ha foreign trained professional program ha na de ya da me jo pe ja mau de ha na tu tao le ja jo ha tao ge ji de ja cha to de pe mo ta mo mo nai sai mo wo no si no no pe ya pao cha le na jo pe ja mau de si ku san ha no ya pi jo ja ka le lo ja ya to cha de a po Targeted Community Capital Project Grant, So yang de kuchi san out so yang ta na jo ha ge ye zhi ya mei bao mong zai le kan yai dao lan ha ho ya so yang jie zhe gu yang le ge pon zhang bo la ha gu gong gang zha hao dun zha le de ji yao ha mei zhi bao mei ha na de han gu zhe yang ba ni niao le no zhe zhe shi ni niao shi shi le so I'm done with the recap and so want to see if anyone here has a question. Has a question, and then we can go on from there. We have still 15 minutes, right? And if Deputy Commissioner has to go, he can leave, or you know, and Daria will be here with us. So let's say any question. Okay, Lisa from she's from District 2 Council. Lisa, go ahead.
So that's our old Business Development Competitive Grant Program. So those are, we normally require that there's other matching funds that go into this program. It's not mandated that there is match, although we like to see as much resources that can go into this. We know, even the resources that we're able to provide now are just part of what our nonprofit lender network and partner network use to provide services all across the state. So we like to see as much leverage as possible, but it's not required.
Yes, Kevin.
Kevin, 30,000 feet. One question on the targeted community capital project grant.
So normally the state and through many programs requires a match. In this targeted capital grant program, there are some exceptions to that. And it's based on the tax capacity of the city in which you're developing. And to be honest with you, we have not, I don't think, we don't have an answer to what that is right now, but we will by the time the RFP gets published. But essentially, it has to do with the tax capacity of a community, and it's a function of how much tax they collect relative to the amount of development and taxable property in their city. So we'll have an answer for that. I can't give you an answer off the top of my head. Yeah. And as we roll it out, we'll have more details.
Yes, Thomas.
So maybe I have a couple questions, and then I have a statement maybe. First question is more like the capital project. You indicated that, for example, Hmong Village has a project and we have to work through a nonprofit organization. So there's no way we can apply directly the funds as to fund through the nonprofit.
Or a city,
yep.
So the two eligible entities are a nonprofit or a city to receive the funds. Yes, you are correct.
So we have to be able to identify the project and work with them. So the time frame for the application process, how long is that process?
We normally keep RFPs open. We're required to keep RFPs open a minimum of 30 days. We are extending some of them 45 days. In the case of this one, maybe a little longer, 60. Again, we're a little concerned. We don't want to leave things open that long. People need to get up and running, and particularly what I mean in the capital grants projects is oftentimes in the winter you're planning your construction projects for the spring, and so next spring hopefully some of these projects would break ground, would be underway. Of course, there's always revitalization of individual buildings, which can occur in the winter, but we may leave it open a little longer depending on the complexity of it.
Following that question, the question I just made, for example, if we identify a building, an existing building, we want to renovate that building, and found out that that building has, we have to do a lot of abatement, lead abatement, mold, and is the fund eligible for that kind of stuff?
So the targeted community grant program, there's two aspects to it. You just have to be completing one phase of a project, okay? So many times the legislature will actually fund design, engineering, pre-development for a project. So if that's a phase of a project that you might be interested in, it would certainly be eligible. Another phase would obviously be the construction phase, which you also see very often out of the legislature. Yeah.
And there's no cap on the funding cap.
1.5 million per grantee. Okay. Yep. Yep. Per project. Yep.
Sorry about that. And then, Coach Hmong, I heard the commissioner indicated earlier that for those of us who received fund previous year were not priority, or is that the small minority grant?
Those are the priority is for the businesses,
lottery.
Not necessarily the lottery, not the cultural malls.
Yeah, that's distinct.
Now, one thing with cultural malls, we did reduce the number of tenants that need to be in a cultural mall to 12, I believe, from I think it was 20. It was much larger in the first round. It you're not impacted by that.
No, we're not. And I'm, as you speak, I'm kind of like thinking, what do I do? What do I need to do to get that again? You know, things like that. But do we need to work with a nonprofit, or we'll work directly with the application? One of our problems is that we don't have the kind of resources like others, and English is my fifth. So writing a fancy proposal to you may not be the best I can do. And so how do we go around working, getting technical assistance and to complete the proposal?
Again, that'll be much like last year. We will be working through nonprofits here in the metro area. That will work with not only the businesses to disperse the grants, but also the cultural malls to disperse their money. And so, you know, part of the other aspect of our small business partnership grant program that was brought up earlier is with more technical assistance money out there, it's certainly feasible that our nonprofit networks can be working with people on various applications and different things that they might be making as part of their technical assistance offering. So that's an option as well. Working with some of them. Yeah.
Yes, and so of that, all the questions I want to thank the commissioner and Daryl. I was one of the most vocal person during the last grant process. And one of the things that we did is we had close to 300 vendors here, and just about 90% of them do not read nor write English. So I have to set up, I have to make my staff help them apply. And so I'm not going to go through that again, and I wanted to be able to find ways to mitigate that so that we don't have to allocate time from our staff time to help our vendors to apply for that grant. Is there a way that we can work with the department to, or, you know, any nonprofit, we're more than willing to set up a desk here in our office, and if you can identify a nonprofit saying, hey, get a staff over there to Hmong Village to help them.
Yeah, that's really up to the, obviously, the nonprofits and your application. We can certainly ask, you know, some of our nonprofits to do it. We've undertaken over the last 6-8 months a variety of online little YouTube videos, and they're how-to videos. And so anything about small business development, where do I register for the Secretary of State, what are things I need to do as a business, we've been publishing these little snippets on YouTube. And we're starting in different languages. The first is Spanish that we'll be doing. Obviously, Hmong is another piece that we would intend to ultimately get up there. And so we're also hoping to have some videos and things that are ahead of time in multiple languages so that the actual businesses know the forms to fill out and how to do it. And I also realize that not everybody has access to. So what you're talking about is someone dedicated here that can actually do the work, and you know, from our perspective, we can certainly ask a nonprofit to do so. They're getting administrative dollars as a result of this. You can ask as well. So we will definitely see what we can do.
Yeah, I don't want to put the burden on you, but I'm thinking of my vendors who, number one, not only illiterate in computer, okay, and technology, but do not know how to read and write. So there is no way that the YouTube can help somebody like me, but may not be able to help someone like them. And so if there is a way that we can work with a nonprofit or someone that can come over here and assist them, like one day a week or a couple of times, we'll work with you.
Yeah, we'll appreciate it. You're our host too, and so,
yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
I hate to cut you off, so.
Thank you.
But I think you two can work together, and so we have more. So,
yeah. I think I can answer Thomas's question. I'm John, I'm the president for Hmong Chamber, and we have this grant now, but our biggest challenge is working with the reimbursement model, right? Because we don't have the budget to pay our contractors up front to help our small business, so can Deed work with us to have some type of cash advancement first, and we can provide a business plan and cost estimates and send that over to you? Because that's been our biggest challenge. That's why we haven't been able to use that $250,000 multi-year state grant in the past, and now we want to bring it back and really try to make it happen this year.
So state grant contracting obviously confirms that we need to do a reimbursement model, okay? That's not a deed decision, that's a state contracting decision. However, we do have the authority to do advances. And I can't remember how much the advance can be, but $25,000, I think, is sort of ringing in my mind for some reason. But that's up to your grant manager. And so I think there will be a new grant manager this round. And then what would happen there is after you apply, they will do a risk analysis and a variety of things that they have to document, and then can front money, essentially. That's what you're asking for, to front money to start incurring expenses that can be reimbursed. So, yeah, we have that ability to do that.
And I think in the appropriation there, too, we tweaked some things on the legal side of stuff, so hopefully we have more flexibility to work with you. But I think on our side, we thought it'd be helpful to you. Sorry, we can chat about this afterwards, but we thought it'd be helpful to you to get a fresh new person who's going to work with you kind of in a different division. So you have a new person, and we'll kind of start fresh on getting that going. Because I know that it was bumpier than probably ideal the last 2 years, so.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Quick question. On the child care grant one, does that apply for in-home child care as well?
So this is generally funding for centers, not in-home childcare. There is, I will note, and Kevin did note this when he was speaking, that we're talking about just the deed funds. It is really, really notable that there's some very significant funding that's coming out. It's through DHS. And so as we noted, the delay here is that we need to coordinate those efforts. So there is going to be some resources in DHS. And off the top of my head, those resources are more like $500 million worth of resources at DHS, and so there'll be some really substantial funding. So wait, I would wait to hear a little bit more, but I think in the childcare space, the state made huge investments.
Yeah. The only thing that I would add to that is the area that we're sort of lacking from DHS's perspective in some of these federal resources is the ability to construct more and to build more. And so that's what we're trying to target our program to, is more of the building of them to create more.
Yeah. Yep. But they do have like subsidies and things on their side of the house.
Yep.
So more to come.
So one quick thing about total grants. So most likely, so if I understand correctly, all your grant programs will be managed through partners, nonprofit organizations, city. Mm-hmm. So all of these will eventually get filtered out by your partners. That's how you apply to it, and then who does the selection of who gets actual approval of which projects it's funded, which ones.
Yeah, generally, at least in the economic development division, we do everything through intermediaries, and you know, NDC, HAP, you name it, cities, in a lot of cases. We don't directly manage very many programs at all. We always send money through. And so that's on our side. On some of the other ones as well, from the workforce side, yes, they'll work through intermediaries that will actually deliver the services, if you will. And yes, the review process. So this is a big concern of ours, as you might guess. We have a lot of RFPs that are out, and a lot will be coming in at the same time. In September. And so we'll have reviewer teams that will be aligned for every program. And what we've done over the past, I don't know, 6-7 years is we engage in community reviewers. So we invite community members to be reviewers and to help us make grant decisions. And so that will be assembled again. We'll have multiple eyes on every application, so that's how that works. Oh, if you want to be a community reviewer, I think
yes.
Just this week we sent out another reminder for people to be community reviewers.
We've got about 100 applications so far, so we would love you all.
Where can you find that? Do
website too?
Yeah, we have the information on our website. Sorry, I keep talking without the mic.
Information's on our website.
Yeah. So please come be a reviewer and help us decide who gets funding.
I just want to, in case Kevin already said it, the point for me to keep get you this information first so that you can attune to that we appropriate the dollars. Now it's at deed control and management. And for you to think about an idea beforehand, you can start networking with the with the nonprofits or state agency now so that when it go further, you know, you're ahead of the game. Some agency, for example, 30,000 feet and Hmong Chamber of Commerce already came to us way before we appropriate. And so they're part of the legislation. So it's slowly going out the gate. Now it's going to go further to a nonprofit out the gate too. And so this is not the end. You know, you still have time when a nonprofit received the RIP and received the grant, they're still going to reach out to you. It's still not too late, but for you to know way beforehand, we are at better edge for this. So
maybe let you know so you can make sure it's part of the deal, right?
Correct. So, Francis?
I was going to ask, there's a lot of programs and information. Is there a centralized place that is at the D website that has a timeline and deadline and all that, right?
Correct.
Yep.
But once we know that, then we work with the nonprofit partner to
correct.
Okay, got it.
And again, I just I can't thank our nonprofits enough for the work that they do in reaching into the communities. I said earlier, you know, on my economic development team, we have 65 people. We run 39 programs more now. I mean, we're not necessarily set up right now to actually administer all of this, so we're hiring as well. So if you know of good people, please, please, we are hiring to administer some of these programs.
We have jobs listed right now.
Yeah.
Billy? Yeah, so my question is, you know, does the partner, you know, the nonprofit, they get an exact amount, a certain amount ahead of time, and so we know how much they have before we even talk to them, or do we apply with just a nonprofit and they will get the money from you guys? Or, you know, but I understand a certain nonprofit are receiving more and certain receive less, and, you know, they might even give it to the people they know. We might not even get it though.
So that's a really good question. I think there's two things that I would probably say to that. Number one, you obviously have to have a project. So there has to be something in the works that you wanted to do, and there's a gap or there's something that is preventing that project from moving forward. Secondly, you've got a number of different programs here that are different and for different uses. Revitalization grants, you know, again, very much project-based, very much around rebuilding, revitalization, very much around, you know, planning has already been underway. We're short $5 million, and we need loan guarantees, we need grants, those types of things. So things coming together, I'm not saying that it's not possible. In this first round, it's going to be very difficult. I'm sure there's plenty of projects around that will get funded. But in future rounds, that does allow for more time. It allows for projects to start getting put together, money to be raised to help do projects. And so if you're thinking about those things, as soon as we name who our nonprofit partners are, I would be talking to them. Absolutely. Yeah, and the partners will apply to us. And so if a partner gets $10 million, you'll know that partner has $10 million. We will announce that on our website. They, in turn, will have their own process, okay? So you would have to go through their process to apply to them in order to ultimately receive funding.
Can I throw a question? Let's say... if a business want to expand facility, did they reach out to a nonprofit now, and then maybe the nonprofit can become your partners, right? Is that correct?
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's exactly the way that it would work. And one thing that I didn't mention about the revitalization program that's a key piece here, there has to be a match. Okay, we're looking to leverage more resources into these projects. You don't have to have the match immediately. We are allowing our nonprofits 15 months before before we would actually take the money away from that nonprofit. So you've got 15 months to be raising money for these projects in order to get the state's investment. Raising money, raising money is not necessarily like the Hmong Chamber or something doing some kind of campaign. It's as much as, you know, going to the going to a bank and getting bank financing. It could be insurance proceeds.
Right.
If something burnt down, if there was damage, yeah. You can use that as matching.
Can it be real estate?
Can you use equity as matching funds?
Let's say I use Hmong Village. Identify Hmong Village as a project. Can we use the equity in Hmong Village as the matching?
Yeah, the equity wouldn't be necessarily the matching side of it. It could contribute, obviously, to it. You could. You could theoretically use that. We have there's some pretty specific things around what the match is. We're looking for those nonprofits to be also investing in these projects or foundations or whomever. Sorry. We know that they are already raising money for various projects, particularly on Lake Street, as an example.
Here, out of the civil unrest.
Right. And so that's exactly what we're expecting. Yep.
Yes, Abib. Yeah, thank you. My name is Abib. I'm actually from NDC, Neighbor Development Center. So I just want to say thank you so much for coming out to present the new programs that's going to be coming out to the community. We're also one of the administrators for the programs throughout the year of 2020, and we're anticipating to participate in this round as well, or rounds to come. But a word of appreciation, you know, just working with so many entrepreneurs out there across multiple ethnic communities. You know, the word that we've been hearing back throughout the year of 2020 was a challenge, like what Thomas said, the communication aspect of it, getting the word out before it actually opened up to the public, you know. So some of these ethnic groups where they don't speak the language, they don't have access to the technology, they may not read and write the language very well. All these different barriers, yeah, were things that we were hearing back, you know. So we appreciate the fact that the department, the both of you, and along with Senator, is coming out before the actual program rollout. You know, I think that's going to play a huge part into making sure that everybody, including these ethnic communities, have access to it on a timely basis. You know, so getting the information, understanding about it, and connecting to the nonprofits, as you've mentioned, and in getting ready for it. You know, so once it's open, that they would have the opportunity to apply just like everybody else in the community. But we've had opportunity to engage with the commissioner, Steve Groh himself as well, and so we appreciate all the resources, the assistance that the department has put out for throughout the year and thus far. You know, so just much gratitude from the community and, you know, from NDC, and on behalf of our organization, we just want to say thank you for the efforts and the resources.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, I was sort of clapping at you.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, we could never have done what we did over the last year without organizations like yours. So, you know, Mike and Renee are very involved in some of this stuff, and so appreciate, obviously, your work. In fact, NDC, LEDC was another one, the Latino Economic Development Center. They speak multiple languages. And the services that they can provide to communities are incredibly, incredibly important. And that's why we're, you know, we're trying to take on multiple languages as well. It's a little bit more complicated in some of the things that we have to do, and certainly our outreach. But we're trying to do the exact same thing. So thank you.
Yeah, so thank you, B, for being here too in D.C. This is one of the largest entity or stakeholder that can be partners to those of you who are entrepreneur. And they had the experience already. And so, you know, hope you can use this time for your own network as well. And there's 30,000 feet and also Hmong Chamber and I District 2 Council. They could also be your partner. So something to think ahead of the game. B, just say exactly correct that, you know, when the gate opened earlier last year, our community weren't aware. By the time we reached there, the money's already gone. So I'm trying to get our community ahead of the game. And also, in the past, I know some of you come to me and I said, there's economic dollar we appropriate to this agency down the road. And then when you go to see them, they don't know where the money is. So my faux pas for that and my, you know, apology for that, but that's why I'm bringing Deed here so that you can see right now it the gate is open. They're going to channel down to nonprofits. Eventually it will reach you, but if you know the purpose beforehand, you're ahead of the game. So I want to thank all of you for being here. I know I could not acknowledge everyone, but you know, I also want to thank the Hmong media as well, the social media group that are being here helping us to channel to our information pipeline. And I want to thank Darielle, our government relations for Deed, and also Deputy Commissioner Kevin McKinnon. And so, you know, Bass for Less is Hmong Village for, you know, letting us having this platform, and also help us with health conscience too. I know that, you know, we already kind of like slowly let go the mask to a recommendation, but Hmong Village still uphold that health mandate, you know, at the high standard. So thank you very much. Let's give a big round of applause to Hmong Village. And I'll pass the mic to Thomas, and you know, we can, those of you, if you have time, you know, I think Darielle is still going to be here, you know, feel free to talk to Darielle, or as long as Deputy Commissioner is still here, I'll be here. You know, as you know, I'm a community person, so I usually the last guy to leave, so I'll be here to talk to all of you too. So thank you.
So on behalf of Hmong Village, I know that I haven't thanked you enough, but I want to face to face thank you for being patient. I know it was difficult last year, not only facing the pandemic, but our vendors are facing a shortage of funding. You know, so when we don't have customer shop, they run out of money, right?